Hello friends, how are you all? My name is Harshit Divedi and I welcome you back to my video. So in this video friends, I am going to talk to you regarding this concept of sea floor spreading. This concept of sea floor spreading friends gave an impetus to the theory of continental drift, which was given by Mr. Alfred Wegener. On that continental drift, I have already made a video friends. The link is given in the description box below. So with this video, also watch the video on the continental drift friends. So in this seafloor spreading, I'm going to tell you this is basically a mid-oceanic ridge. Here it is the mid-Atlantic ridge at which seafloor spreading is taking place. So at the mid-Atlantic ridge, the rocks are the youngest. As you are going to move far away from this mid-Atlantic ridge, the rocks will, you know, be a little more aged. They will be older. Here is the Africa continent and here is the South American continent. So all the details about this seafloor spreading, I will be discussing with you in this friends. In this video. So this is basically a geologic process friends, in which slowly new crust is being produced, new oceanic crust is being produced, a slow addition of oceanic crust is there through volcanic activity. Magma is coming out on the ocean floor, it is getting cooled, and obviously the rock, and you know, as soon as the new magma is coming to the floor, new rocks are being produced, new oceanic crust is being produced. So the existing oceanic crust is being, you know, thrown away a little bit farther from the existing mid-oceanic ridge, and then it becomes an old rock. So obviously, as new rocks are being produced, the older rocks are being shifted outwards, and that is why the new rocks are less dense than the older rocks. And as soon as the older rocks go far and far, they become more and more older, and the rocks which are nearer to the mid-oceanic ridge are younger in age. Okay, and this whole process of seafloor spreading is taking place when the tectonic plates are splitting across from each other. Now see friends, continental drift theory was incomplete. Seafloor spreading theory is also not complete. The complete picture will come in front of you when you will also know about plate tectonics. So the link of the plate tectonics I will give in the description box below. If by chance I forgot it, kindly search it on my channel. You will get it. Now moving forward, let's have a background of this thing. Himalayas are called as the roof of the world, friends. Okay, now why the Himalayas are called as a rooftop of the world? The fact is that, friends, they host one of the highest peaks of the earth. For example, this Mount Everest, which stands at 8,848 meter above the sea level, friends. So this is also found in Himalayas. Similarly, other ranges like Kanchenjunga, K2, you know, all of these are found in, you know, Himalayas only. So this Mount Everest is in Nepal. Now see, when some amount of research was done by these geologists found that the rock which is found at the topmost of the Mount Everest is limestone. Now when we talk about limestone, things come into our mind. Limestone is basically a rock which is formed in shallow seas with warm waters, and it contains many fossilized marine creatures, friends. Okay, and these creatures vary from plankton to fish. Now the scientists are thinking that this limestone rock, it is formed in warm shallow seas, it contains fossilized creatures like fish. How the hell has this limestone reached at the top of Mount Everest? Now this was something to which nobody has an answer. That things that are found in seas, in, you know, aquatic environments, you know, this limestone rock is formed in shallow seas. How can this limestone rock be found at the top of the Mount Everest? So this thing irritated those time geologists for a very long time. And when for a very long time, these geologists were not able to tell the reason of the same, then who will come into play? Religion will come into play. Because religion claims that it knows everything. And then this thing was associated with what? The Noah floods. Now, what is this Noah flood? Noah Ark appears in the Genesis flood narrative. This says that there was a Genesis flood narrative. Now this Genesis flood narrative said that a word engulfing flood came, and God saved Noah and his family and remnants of all world animals on a boat from this word engulfing flood. So this Noah flood says that a word engulfing flood came and God saved Noah, his family, and remnants of all world animals on that, you know, boat. So this was the narrative given by the, you know, religious interpretation, which was actually wrong. Then came the contraction theory. Contraction theory was actually an independently proposed theory. It came forward in 1900s. So this was basically based on the thing that when a thing gets cooled, it shrinks, it becomes wrinkled. So this was a thing said. It was said that after very heavy volcanic eruption, when a lot of molten magma came on the surface, now when that cooled, then wrinkling occurred. Okay, so when after its formation the earth cooled, planet's surface contracted and wrinkled, and because of this wrinkling and contraction, the mountain ranges formed. Mountain ranges like Himalayas, Alps, these formed. So this was the logic which was given by the geologist. This was known as the contraction theory. So this theory said that one cooling event came, and because of that one cooling event, all the features on earth, especially the mountains, had formed. And after that, when the cooling has occurred, it has subsided, then the planet has become relatively static, and it is now not cooling, and it is halted in this position since millions of years. But the theory of uniformitarianism given by Hutton, that said that earth is changing continuously, so some contradictions were still there. Now then came the theory of Wegener theory of continental drift. Now I made a separate theory on this Wegener theory of continental drift. This is actually very important, friends. Okay. Now Mr. Wegener said that there was a supercontinent Pangaea. And from that supercontinent Pangaea, all the continents broke apart. And today, whatever orientation of these continents we are seeing, they are once a part of this Pangaea. And for this, he gave many proofs, friends. He gave the proofs of matching shorelines of African continent and South American continent. He gave the proofs of fossils. He gave the proof of glacial erosions in Africa, where no glaciation can happen at this point of time because it is in equators in the plains of Africa. Then he said that North America, it is not having any evidences of glacial erosion, because and still many parts of North America like Canada, Alaska, so basically they are found in higher latitudes, so glaciers are existing there. So why this anomaly is there? Why this mismatch is there? And by this, Mr. Wegener proved that these continents drifted. But the problem was that Mr. Wegener was not able to tell the exact reason that why this continent broke apart. So this was something which Mr. Wegener was not able to explain. Okay, and why Mr. Wegener was not able to explain it? See, friends, around 70% or more than 70% of the earth is water. Around 30% is earth. Mr. Wegener was studying the 30%. The 70% of our earth which was under the oceans, that was not visible to Mr. Wegener, and that is why Mr. Wegener was not able to tell that why continents are drifting apart. Okay, and this thing came forward in front of people when technology got forward, and things came in front of people during the world wars. Now we are going to discuss this, friends. Okay, now till 1920s, it was being said, and before 1920s, I should say, people thought that the ocean's basin, that is a deep ocean floor, would be very flat. It would be a flat thing. There would be no feature on it. It would be featureless. Okay. But what happened during World War I? A lot of ships were being formed, and those ships had sonar instruments on them. Now, sonar instruments basically propagate sound waves to know what objects are there at separate places. Submarines basically operate on the principle of sonar also, because sonar guides the movement of submarines. Now those, on the basis of those sonar, actually the reason of deputing that sonar was to find out the locations of the enemy ships, enemy submarines. But what happened, that sonar sound waves is propagated in all direction. So basically on the basis of the sonar data, mapping of ocean floor was done. And when the mapping of this ocean floor was done, scientists found and geologists found that actually this ocean floor, which was believed to be featureless and flat, it is actually not flat. It is actually not featureless. It is actually having a lot more things that our continents are having. It is having great valleys, big valleys deeper than the Grand Canyon. It is having mountain chains which can give competition to Andes in height and length. So a lot of these things are happening, friends. Vast plains are even greater than the earth, because 70% of our earth is actually water. Okay. So this thing came in front of the scientist. And the most important thing which came in front of scientists was the long mid-oceanic ridge in the Atlantic Ocean. And it was being seen that this ridge at the point of emergence of lava was 1 to 2 kilometers above the surrounding or the nearby ocean basin. Now see here. This thing has to be understood through a diagram. See, this is the mid-oceanic ridge. Now you can see this mid-oceanic ridge is at a height. Okay. So you can see that this mid-oceanic ridge is at a height than the nearby oceanic depth. So obviously it is 1 to 2 kilometers, you know, at a height, you can say. And at this mid-oceanic ridge, molten lava is coming out. And when you are going to see the shape and orientation of this mid-oceanic ridge, it is actually parallel to the shape line of the continents. For example, this mid-Atlantic ridge, it is running between Africa and South America. And South American and African coastlines exactly match with each other. This was told by Wegener also. Okay. Now, if you are going to see the orientation of this mid-oceanic ridge, it is in accordance with these shorelines. So, everything on the basis of this was saying that yes, these continents actually broke apart from each other. And similar type of mid-oceanic ridges were found in Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean by the explorers. Okay. Now, this seafloor spreading theory in completion was put forward by an American geophysicist whose name was Harry H. Hess in 1960. Okay, now Harry H. Hess used sonar. Okay, this sonar was deployed for getting a position of the enemy's vessels, but actually it also discovered the mid-Atlantic ridge, the mid-oceanic ridge. Now, some observations were being made by Harry H. Hess. We are going to see those observations. Harry H. Hess said that the temperature near this mid-Atlantic ridge is warmer. And obvious reason for that was that molten magma was coming out at this mid-oceanic ridge. So obviously that much amount of heat is coming out from the, you know, interior of the earth. So obviously that area is going to be warm. Then the surrounding areas, which would be cold, obviously. Okay. Then it was said that at this mid-oceanic ridge, this molten magma is coming out, and then this molten magma is getting cooled down. Crystallization is happening and new oceanic crust is formed. New rocks is formed. New oceanic crust is formed. So the existing oceanic crust will be extended apart. It will be thrown up, a bit far away. So obviously, the oceanic rocks, new oceanic rocks are found at the mid-oceanic ridges. Okay. And obviously, the existing rocks at the mid-oceanic ridges, they will be sent a little bit farther from the mid-oceanic ridge. So new crust is being formed. Okay. Now see, friends, this formation of the new crust is due to the rising of molten magma from the mantle by convectional current. Okay. And when this molten magma reaches the oceanic crust, it cools and pushes away the existing rock from the ridge equally in both directions. See, this is the convection cell, friends. You see, so this is the direction here and this is the direction here. Okay. Now this convectional cell theory, this I will be explaining you in a separate video. So that cannot be explained here. I'm not going to merge both the topics because of that, the video will become a too long and too boring. So I'm skipping that here. So when this convectional current theory, I will be telling you in a separate video. So this convectional current theory is pushing this crust here, and that is why this crust is broken apart. Okay. And magma is coming out of here. Okay. So this is being said here. See, formation of the new crust is due to the rising of molten material magma from the mantle by convectional current. Okay. And when this molten magma reaches the oceanic crust, it cools down and forms new oceanic crust. So a younger oceanic crust is formed, and this spreads the ocean floor. And the existing ocean floor gets shifted a little bit farther from the mid-oceanic ridge. Now see, the density of the new oceanic floor formed is less than the old floor. So the rocks that are older in age, their density will be higher than the rocks which are newly formed. So this is one thing. And as soon as the rock is going to move forward from the mid-oceanic ridge, it will be more denser, it will be more colder, and it will be more deeper. And finally, after some time, either that older rock will reach a trench and get destroyed, convert itself into magma and go to mantle, or it will reach a coast and subduction will happen. That is the thick and dense oceanic crust will go beneath the continental crust. Okay. So this is one more thing, friends. The important things that I am telling you, kindly keep focus on these things. This is very, very important. So you can hear, see, friends, mid-oceanic, which is there. This is pushing apart here. The crust has been broken. So obviously, here new rocks would be formed, younger rocks would be formed. Here a little bit older rocks will be there. Here a little bit more older rocks will be there. And finally, either these older rocks are going to meet the trenches. So in trenches, what will happen? Important trenches of the world, and what is basically happening in a trench. I've made a separate video in it. I will give the link in the description box below. So kindly watch it. So in the trenches, the oceanic floor gets destroyed. The rocks convert themselves back into the magma and go into the mantle. So this is what is happening at a trench. Now what is happening when the rock oceanic floor is not reaching the trench? So if it is not reaching the trench, it will reach a coast. There it will get, it will, you know, clash with the continental crust, and this oceanic crust will get beneath the continental crust, because oceanic crust is much more denser than the continental crust. So these are the two things that this oceanic crust is going to do. Either it will subduct below continental crust, or it will destroy itself at a trench. Now see, if we compare both Atlantic Ocean and Pacific Ocean, you will see that in Atlantic Ocean the number of trenches are less. In Pacific Ocean, the number of trenches are high. So obviously, if in Atlantic Ocean, the number of trenches is less, and if it's Pacific Ocean, the number of trenches is high. So more amount of ocean floor is getting destroyed in the Pacific Ocean, and less amount of ocean floor is getting destroyed in the Atlantic Ocean. So obviously, it is being said that Atlantic Ocean is widening and Pacific Ocean is closing down. And what will happen after some time? This I've already told you in the Pangaea supercontinent video. It is being said that one time will come when the Atlantic Ocean will completely open itself, Pacific Ocean will completely close itself, and again all the continents will meet to form a new supercontinent, just as was the case with Pangaea. So Pangaea was not the first supercontinent. So these type of things are happening continuously. Okay, now moving forward. Now we are going to see the magnetic stripes investigation. Now this is very important, friends. See, just focus on this. It is a little bit tricky, but yes, you will be able to understand. It is not impossible to understand these things. So what happened, friends, that when the investigation of this mid-oceanic ridge was going on, okay, so what happened that when distances and the ages of the rocks were compared, and when their magnetic polarity was compared. So from the mid-oceanic ridge, after some years, if you are going to see the rock, there will be some magnetic polarity of that rock. And if you are going to go a little bit more farther away, so the magnetic polarity of the rocks after some amount of time was reversing. Let us have a look at this figure. Just read that text. I will request you to read this complete text. So this will be helpful to you. So when you are going to read this text, I'm just reading it. First, the stripes of normal and reverse polarity were alternate across the bottom of the ocean. Second, the alternate stripes of normal and reverse polarity formed a mirror ridge on either side of the ridge. Third is the abrupt ending of the stripes when it reached the edge of the continent or an ocean trench. It was concluded that the seafloor is composed of different rocks according to ages, and that they are positioned equally in opposite direction. This records that there is a constant movement and spreading of rocks on the ocean floor. Now what this thing is saying, I'm going to tell you. See, this is the mid-oceanic ridge. Now this says that after some time here, the magnetic polarity of the rock would be something. Go a little bit farther here, the magnetic polarity will reverse. So whatever is the magnetic polarity in this position 1, at the position 2, the magnetic polarity will change itself. So this was being told through this magnetic investigation. Then if you are going to go on the other side of this mid-oceanic ridge here, so here also the magnetic polarity of this 3 will be same as the magnetic polarity of 1, because this aged rocks are equally distanced from mid-oceanic ridges. And when you are going to move farther away, this one is 4, so the magnetic polarity of 4 will be similar to the magnetic polarity of 2, but the magnetic polarity of 3 will be opposite to the magnetic polarity of 4. So an exact mirror edge is formed having mid-oceanic ridge as the center. So as you are going to move away from the mid-oceanic ridge in one direction, after some amount of time, the magnetic polarity of the rocks is changing, because the magnetic pole of the earth is changing. And when a rock is formed, it takes the polarity of that time magnetic pole. And when after millions of years, another rock is formed, then the magnetic pole has at that point of time changed its position. So at that point of time, the new magnetic pole polarity will be taken up by the new rocks. And this type of phenomena is found at both sides of the oceanic ridge. So this proves that this is happening. The third thing which was being told, that these magnetic stripes are being formed until and unless the oceanic floor reaches an oceanic trench or it reaches a coast. And as soon as the oceanic floor reaches a trench or a coast, this magnetic property is existent. Whenever it, you know, when the oceanic floor is moving towards the trench or a coast, this magnetic property is there. As soon as it gets destroyed as the trench or it meets the coast, this magnetic stripe thing vanishes. So this also proves, friends, that rocks inside and the ocean floor inside is constantly moving in opposite direction. There is a constant movement of rocks, spreading of rocks on the ocean floor. So all the important points about this thing I've already told you in detail. I hope this video was helpful for you, friends. The Hindi version is available. So thank you for watching this video, friends. Thank you for being patient. Please tell me through your comment sections below that how you really like this video. So thank you for watching this, friends. Have a great day. Goodbye.